you've got my 7th Spitfire project in my lifetime. It's a Mark 22 Spitfire. I sold my main projects 200 years ago, but still want to be a member of the Spitfire Owners Club, and so I've started to piece together my 7th project. All genuine parts, all the thermal Spitfires. At this stage, it's just like an armature with the bits hanging on it. I can guarantee that within 50 years, I'll be 120 odd, but the Spitfire will be flying. When you're a schoolboy, as you get to sort of like 12, 13, it's always collecting train numbers in the year and on books and writing them through. Didn't do that for me. But I was interested in aeroplanes, and it quickly developed into becoming old aeroplanes. And Second World War, which seemed like an old aeroplane, although at that time they're only sort of like 10 or 15 years after the war. And I had a very strong interest in Spitfires, and I and my pal Trevor Chu, in the fourth and fifth year of school, we would cycle to look at aeroplanes we knew, but the gate guardians. They put Spitfire on a gate, and anything that was within 50 miles, and we could cycle 100 miles in a day. The term aeroplane spotter, spotting is what we were doing, always with a camera. I can remember one particular, we were still at school, so it had been 58, and there was a combined cadet force, and there were air cadets in the school, and they came back and said, "We've just been down to RAF Kenley, and there's a Spitfire crashed in the side of the hill." I said, "What?" So Trevor, I said, "Oh gosh, can't be." Anyway, next Saturday, I know it was cold because it was raining, but we cycled right across central London to Kenley, locked our bikes to the chain at the periphery fence, and said, "We'll do a complete external transit round there to see if this is true." And we'd gone, I don't know, 300 or 400 yards, and there's this Spitfire, just a... It hadn't crashed, it had been dumped there and was used for fire practice. So, well, we will climb over the fence, sit in it and have a photo and take the photographs, and still got the photographs now. And they are now famous photographs because the aeroplane disappeared. It just went off the radar. It didn't appear in any of the scrap yards, which were monitored by enthusiasts then. Where's it gone? Well, in fact, the Air Force chopped it up and buried it. And the RAF Museum went looking for it in the 80s or 90s, or 80s, 80s, didn't find it. But another group of enthusiasts found it and then separated all the parts out and kept them all in different places so that there could be no claim on getting the whole aircraft back. The years rolled by, and eventually they sold it to a chap called Peter Arnold, who's the big operation at Biggin Hill, and it's been rebuilt. It flies, and it flies now with a Dutch supermarket Baron. Yeah, same aeroplane. I got to the end of what would be the O-level year. I hadn't worked very hard. I didn't actually fit into the school that well. So I passed all O-levels in all the woodwork, metalwork, engineering, drawing, physics, chemistry and so on, but I failed abysmally. Well, I failed maths and English. And so the advice was to stay an extra term from the summer of 58 till the Christmas 58 and retake them at Christmas, which I decided to do. And I've said to my grandkids, and they smile, and you'll perhaps smile, it was the best thing that ever happened to me. "Granddad, how can that possibly be?" I said, "Well, I was 16, and there was a girls' school just down the road, a private girls' school. And I, Trevor and my mate, we had various ways we'd get back to my house, and we went down this way, which actually passed the girls' school. And there were a couple of girls coming up that way. And they were very attractive, and we just sort of did a banter for 2 seconds and moved on. And I said the next day, let's go back, we might see those two girls again. Anyway, to cut a long story short, one of them I fell madly in love with, and we've been married 58 years. This next Monday, same girl. She was the one, and she's always been the one. So the Spitfire Angels was bubbling along, but gradually I then asked this lovely lady, would she marry me? And she said yes. So my relationship with Trevor started to drop away, and my relationship with my fiance and the Spitfire interest was just, it was there, but it was not, it was plateaued is the word I use. I was still in, you know, you still read aviation magazines, and this thing about, they're going to do a film about the Battle of Britain, it's going to be big. It was on with one company, and it was off, and it was on again with another company, and it was up and down. Finally, about 1966, 67, it's definitely on. And my uncle, who was a fighter pilot in the war, flying Typhoons, and was still in the Air Force, I said, do you know anything about this film? He said, yeah, well, it's being, they're gathering the aircraft at RAF Henlow. He said, get yourself over there. And so there was no security there. I went to see, like I said, saw this, go over that way. It's all been done over that way. And there was an RAF engineering officer, and he told him what I was doing. He said, oh yeah, help yourself, go in there, yeah. You'll see the guy. He said, just wander in, it's okay, no problem, take any photo, yeah, okay. So I became a regular going over to the aircraft being prepared for the Battle of Britain film. This is through 67. And the filming started in 68. The weather was just appalling, and they had all sorts of problems there. But I did have special access to go to the film set on a couple of occasions, managed to sort of, I started to write a magazine article, you know, and I'm the aviation correspondent of Old Moore's Almanac type thing, you know. And I got to get better at writing the letters, and managed to get access to the film set. It rained, but I got there because I take my photo lessons where the aircraft are actually participating in the film, and the film came out in 69.
Faced with certain defeat, fighting against insuperable forces, a miracle was achieved by a courageous few.
And it was fantastic. I mean, it is a cult film, terrific following, didn't make any money, but they were real aircraft, no CGIs. At the end of the filming, I thought, I'll have one last go over to RAF Henlow. This will be my last visit. And I went over, and I'm so glad I did, because it's almost a life-changing moment for me that transpired. Went into the hangar, and there were two people talking. One was a Canadian, and he was talking to John Hawke, who was the pilot of the camera ship, which was the converted bomber that all the cameras on to film the air-to-air filming. I got talking to them, and I could see there was obviously a sale going on here. Somebody's trying to buy an airplane. And the Canadian guy, Don Plum, came up to me afterwards. I was just there. He said, you seem to know a lot about Spitfire. I said, well, yeah, quite a bit. He said, is this legitimate, this airplane? I'm not sure what's going on here. I said, well, I would check it out a bit. It's not quite right. He said, can I have my phone number? I said, yeah, no problem, have my phone number. And he gave me a ring. He said, yeah, you were actually right. He said, he didn't own the aeroplane. He had a reputation. He was just trying to make money. Hamish, had he owned the aeroplane? I said, well, that's what I thought. I didn't want to say it. Had to be good. And he said, could you get me a Spitfire? 27 years old. Where'd you get a Spitfire? I said, well, I'll have a try. I knew that at the end of the filming, they sold some of the aeroplanes off. And so Willie Roberts, he had bought basically two flying aeroplanes and two non-flying aeroplanes. And I knew his engineer, and I said, I'm looking for a Spitfire. I said, well, Willie might sell one. And yeah, sure, he's prepared to sell. He only wants one flying two-seat Spitfire. I said, it's a two-seater. Come and have a look at it. It's actually based at Elstree at the moment. And he came over and the deal was done. And I subsequently passed over a banker's draft for, I think it was $12,750. Willie had bought it for $10,000. At the beginning of the film, they were $6,000, so they were going up. It seemed like a lot of money, but it looks small when you compare to the same aeroplane is now worth £4 or 5 million. Anyway, I bought the aeroplane, and Tom said he decided he wasn't going to get it flying straight away. He wanted it totally taken apart and completely refurbished. And so a year, 18 months later, it flew. And then he said, it was 1972, he said, I'd like to come over to fly in the aeroplane. And he bought me a ticket. And it just developed and rolled on and on and on. Bomb came along, no one knew about it, just bang, the war stopped. You've got all these people and all these aircraft production, what are you going to do with it? You know, it all just slowed right down. The RAF had hundreds and hundreds of surplus Spitfires parked out on airfields, just with minimal protection. What are we going to do with them? Vickers, you know, all of a sudden they've got to start winding everything down. So what they did, and with government approval, they would move these airplanes, either sell them or even give them to various other countries to still keep a sphere of influence. So you found that the Swedish government, Danish, Norwegian, French, Italian, Greek, Thai, Israeli, Syria, they all started to re-equip with surplus RAF Spitfires. Now all these aircraft are spread right out, and then they've used, and then they've gone into the down and scrapped and accidents and scrap yards, and of course, and there's enthusiasts in these countries. I was communicating with these people. Oh, we've got a guy down the road, and he's got half a dozen bloody undercarriage legs, etc. So I was communicating all around the world, and I could find a guy looking for a part. Well, I haven't got one, but I know somebody over, you know, in Australia's got some bits, you know. So I was in the middle of all these, and enjoying, because I had as much enthusiasm to enjoy seeing these aeroplanes built for no commercial gain. Well, as I was collecting bits and pieces, got to about 73, and a couple of aircraft came out of the scrapyard, and I was able to bring a deal together, and I ended up as a half owner of a Seafire 46. My friend Neville Franklin, who was part of the New York Air Museum, he ended up with this front end, the partial of a fuselage, and was able to give these things. And it was just enthusiasts amongst enthusiasts. Well, I started to say, well, I can find some cowlings, and I can find a bit here. If we go back to the guy who had it before, he's still got the front end, and so on. So I was doing all the work, and my friend was accumulating in his own. I said, well, I keep finding these bits. Don't you think I ought to be half owner? He said, yeah, good idea. So I became half owner of the aeroplane. And then another life-changing thing happened in the situation. Trevor, my friend Trevor, worked at British Airport Authority on Heathrow. And he said, the Navy, the historic flight of the Navy, brought their Fairy Firefly up to Heathrow for some commemoration. And he got talking to the chief petty officer there while they're doing this thing. He said, oh, my pal's got a bit of a sea fire. He said, oh, he said, that's interesting. He said, funny enough, we were at a scrapyard in Warrington looking for radiators for the Fairy Firefly. And he said, the chap there said he got a couple of Seafires in the scrapyard. Can't be right. We're now talking 73. So, but you've got to check them out. So I thought, I knew somebody who lived quite close. He was in the aviation enthusiast. He said, look, wearing my hat, not your own, would you just go down and check this story out? He came back and said, I've been down there, you aren't going to believe this. The scrap dealer said, yes. So I went up there the next day, car. And he said, yeah, they're in that pile there. He said, I'll bring a crane over and we start pulling bits around. We pulled out two Seafire 17s. I mean, you look at the photograph, everybody thought I was mad. You know, they were burnt, charred, tail broken off. I saw them basically as a source of spare parts. And I paid £175 for these two wrecks. And I said to Neville, look, how about I'll give you the best of these wrecks and the back end of that other C-546 so you've got a complete aeroplane with an engine for your half share in the better project. Now, somebody said, well, you must have been crazy, but it was a good deal for me because I ended up with the best of the parts. And that's how I became the sole owner of the C-546. And then I brought that down to my home at Redbourne. The press got wind of it, as it tends to. I said, well, I'll have a press day, it'll be about 2 or 3 weeks' time, and I'll get it out. I'll get it all out for you. Fine. As well, I thought, I wonder, why don't I ring Anglia Television, which is a local television, and see if they're interested in coming? So I rang them, and I said, yeah. Anyway, then, well, it's great, I'll ring the BBC. I'll just ring the BBC, I'll ring Nationwide. I got straight through, and I said what it was, and I said, I'm having this press day on, you know, next Wednesday or whatever it was, and they said, oh yeah, we already know about this, we're sending Sue Lawley.
Peter Arnold is a Luton car worker, but the Arnold garage doesn't house the family saloon. That's reserved for a much larger version of the internal combustion engine. Arnold, Biggles to his friends, is building an aeroplane in his garage. A Vickers Supermarine Seafire F Mark 46 serial number LA564. One of only 24 built in the mid-40s.
Yep.
It's the culmination of a 5-year search for spare parts from museums, stores and crash sites all over the world. And with a little help from his friends and the wife, Peter's project is beginning to get off the ground. About 23,000 Spitfires, the fighter plane that won the Battle of Britain, were built, but only about 150 are still in existence. It's a case of shopping and swapping to get the right parts. Today, Peter is swapping a Barracuda undercarriage leg for a tail fin of a Mark 22 Spitfire. It's just what he's been looking for.
Lovely job.
How did you get all these bits and pieces together in the first place?
Well, I've been collecting bits now for, I guess, about 5 years. Just this last 3 weeks, they've all come together in one bit in the garage.
So this is your own first own Spitfire, is it?
Well, certainly, but this is the first time it's all come together. I've owned bits of pieces, I've had bits on joint ownership, but as of about 3 weeks ago, it all belongs to me.
How does that make you feel?
Very, very happy and very, very satisfied.
What are you actually going to do with it when you've put it all together?
Well, it's a very long job, as you can see, to get it into something like museum shape. But I guess in the next 2 or 3 years, I'm hoping to get it into the Newark Air Museum up in Nottinghamshire.
But, I mean, what's going to happen? I mean, every day you're going to come along and get it out and start putting it together, and then every night you've got to put it back again?
No, I think we'd have the price of the houses dropping dramatically if we did that. No, what I'm going to do, the garage is about 18 foot long and the main fuselage is just under 18 foot. I can happily work on it at night when there's a bit of free time. And the engine, well, that can go in storage until I'm ready to pick it up.
Must take up an awful lot of your spare time.
It's taken up a lot of spare time over these last few weeks, but really it's just an ordinary hobby, just like collecting stamps, only I collect bits of Spitfire.
It had 6 minutes on Nationwide when they only had 3 stations, and it went around the country, you know. And then all of a sudden it was in all the newspapers, so that all the national papers picked it up, so it's your name is starting to be associated with Spitfires, and it just grew and grew and grew. Big bonus for the being on the television. I rang Rolls Royce down at Leavesden, which is the old de Havilland engine at Rolls Royce, and yeah, come bring us down, we saw you on the television, come on down, you know, let's see, help me with this engine, I got this beat up engine. Look, bring it in, we can't get it running, but we'll rebuild it for you. It turns out that the guy running the apprentice school I was at school with, handy. I then spoke to British Aerospace at Hatfield, the old De Havilland, and I said, look, they've got this tail unit, it's all been, it's two pieces that they overlap. Bring it in, well, the apprentice school can sort that out for you. So it just started to grow and grow. A friend of mine said, I've got a client who wants to get a Spitfire project for the family, and do you want me to include your two? And I said, well, you know, I'm coming up 60. I'm not going to live forever. I've taken the two projects I've got about as far as I can. I've never been in getting airplanes to fly. That was way, way beyond my pay grade. And I said, well, yeah, what do you think they're, what do you think they're worth? And he quoted me a number. So I said, well, you can put it on the list. And I didn't think anything of it because I thought he came back to me just shortly before redundancy. He was just very, very close. He said, well, he said, you won't believe this. He said, I've offered them six projects around the world. They want to take your pay. I said, well, what about the price? Yeah, happy with the price. And so I sold them. It was an enormous amount of money. That money's been invested and it's given us a chance to... We've always loved travelling, so... We've set off on 20 years of retirement and going away once, twice, sometimes three times a year, all over the world. Started to go to Australia on a regular basis, doing the job for Ford Australia. I put them onto independent rear suspension. It was just on my own, and I would commute there, and we would fly the vehicles backwards and forwards on a 747. And my company said, I would go business class, but they said to me, look, we get an allowance for we can charge business class with Ford because of the arrangements. He said, if you want to go economy, we'll give you £500. And the company had £500. I said, well, that sounds attractive, but actually, you know, 24 hours on the plane, it's, you know, it's... So, but how? If I've got £500, I can actually take okay with me. So I get another car. And also, for just a little bit more money, and I used to cut my own tickets, and I found always went through trail finders, never failed me. I could buy a round the world ticket, just not that much more, because you're always halfway around the world, so it's not that much more. So I found ways of getting to Australia that you wouldn't believe, like Buenos Aires, Santiago, Easter Island, Tahiti, New Zealand, finally arrive up at Melbourne. So a bit late, you know, I just took a few days holiday along the way. So I started to see all the Spitfires, and gradually, with holidays, we'll go out via Hong Kong to see a Spitfire there, then we'll go to Australia, and we'll dot around and we must see Ayers Rock, and we'll end up at Perth. There's a Spitfire at Perth on the way back. Then we'll go to Thailand where there's a Spitfire, which I'd seen before. Then we'll go into Burma, which is tricky. First thing there, excuse me, sir, you're only allowed one camera in the country. You're allowed one camera. Just pick that up on the way out of the country. You've got 5 days and then you've got to go. That's the way it was. You know, it's a tricky country then, it's even trickier now. I then wanted to look at the... There was a Spitfire on the gate, a gate guardian at the Burmese Air Force station at Rangoon, and Yangon. And further up country, about 20 kilometres up there was a place called Morbi where there was another Spitfire and a Seafire on poles. But that's not open to Westerners, that area. That's how it was. So as we'd arrived, we got into this beat-up old Chevrolet, which was an ex-diplomatic car, but it's a taxi driver. It had wires on the floor, broken glass everywhere, no carpet. And I said, where are you? He said, I'm always around the hotel. I said, do you know this aeroplane on the gate? He said, yeah, can you take me there? Yes. Now, we know other people who've got close and shooed away, no cameras, because it was just inside the gate. Fine, I want you to drive me past very slowly while I've got my lens. That's okay, he said. I said, I want to go to Morbi. He said, that's a no-no there for Westerners. Can't take you up there. And there's a golden rule here. How does a bottle of Johnny Walker? Perfect, he said. That's State Express and Johnny Walker. They are the two, in all the guidebooks, those are the two keys to making things happen. So That afternoon, off I went. I got the Sunday Times and the camera on a long lens, and we drove slowly past there and put it all away. I got the photographs of the one I wanted on the gate. Not close to it, just on the gate. And then we got about, just a quarter mile up the road on the way to Morby. Up came a soldier, Westerner. The driver got out. There was a lot of talking. All of a sudden, there was an exchange of money, and there's a pass on the front of the windscreen. So off we went. And I got up to these two aeroplanes, and there was a soldier there with a gun. He obviously thought I had the... I said, would you like a pen? Oh, yes, please. Took all the photographs, came back to the hotel. I'd seen the three aeroplanes I wanted to see, ticked the boxes, and she said the defence attaches came to see us. I told him he'd sort of gone out on a reconnaissance. He said, good idea. She said, it's all fixed for tomorrow. The following day, we did the same trip again, but this time got out to the aircraft with a major from the Air Force, the defence attaché, the Land Rover. Out came the ladders, off came the powers, anything you want doing, photograph, data plates, the whole thing. We did all three airplanes. So I came back with all the identities of the airplanes, and it was absolutely wonderful. Defence attaché, he became my sort of spy. He said, I've been up to this base up in Mike Tilly. He said, there's a Spitfire on the gate there. Or a Spitfire. Said, and here's a photograph of it. You know. And he said, they've got another one, you know, in the hangar. And in the end, I got sort of, he found it advantageous. And I started to write letters, and they would actually do inspections for me. But when it came to going to see the aeroplane, one of them, it was always a no. I don't know why. I don't have a bucket list other than I want to see that last Spitfire. If there's an opportunity, I would go. Well, I'm proud that by helping people all around the world with their Spitfires, how it's generated so much admiration. I'm not sure what the right word is. Respect, I think. An acknowledgement that I'm now Mr. Spitfire, and that I get called upon. And can you write an article? Can you take? Can we record it for posterity? So risen slowly to the top of the. That not the Spitfire owners, but the Spitfire world, to I won't say the top, but that's given me a lot of satisfaction. You know, I can look back on that and say, yeah, job done.